It is good to be in the house of the Lord again today. Yes. Psalm chapter 37 is where we're going to read from. Amen. And we have been rejoicing in the Lord this week. Amen. Psalms 37, and we'll begin to read with, let me grab this thing. Didn't use this, and so we're going to put this thing to our mouth a little bit, not because I need it, but because they say that I need it in order to record the services. Amen. Now, for the last week on Sunday morning, we taught about, amen, the pathway, amen, or the direction that God would have, amen, the way to God is through the heart, and then we spoke. The second message is, where is your love? Amen. And for if you will set your affection on things above and not on the things of the earth. Amen. It's whenever you set your affection, amen. Affection is another word for love. Amen. Affection comes, you never hear somebody say, I love you with all my mind. But you do hear him saying, I love you with all my heart. Amen. Because it's that part of an individual. It's the passion part of the individual. On Wednesday night, we continued with that thought, and we taught David, a man after God's own heart, and some of the things that David had, amen, as far as within his heart. Amen. He was a man of faithfulness, and he was a man, amen, of endurance. He was a man of patience, and he was a man that loved the things of God. He was a man of sacrifice, and we had a list of six different things. I don't have them in front of me right now, but we did have a phenomenal Bible study, and I have to say, if it wasn't for anybody else, I enjoyed it. Amen. But we had a wonderful Bible study on Wednesday night. Now, this morning, amen, we're going back to Psalms 37, and we will read in verse number 3, where it said, trust in the Lord. Amen. If we could stand in honor to the reading of the word, thank you. Amen. Psalms 37 and verse number 3 said, trust in the Lord and do good. So shalt thou dwell in the land. Verily thou shalt be fed. Delight thyself also in the Lord. He shall give thee the desires of thy heart. Commit thy way unto the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. He shall bring forth thy righteousness as the light, thy judgment as the noonday. Rest in the Lord, and wait patiently for him. Fret not thyself because of him who prospereth in his way, because of the man who bringeth wicked devices to pass. Cease from anger, let me not do that. Amen. Cease from anger. Amen. Don't be angry. And forsake wrath. Fret not thyself in any wise to do evil. Amen. For evildoers shall be cut off. But those that wait upon the Lord, they shall inherit the earth. He said, you don't worry about the fella, amen, that is prospering in his way. Amen. Because he's brought some wicked devices and he's able to bring his prospering is because of his wickedness. Don't you worry about him. Amen. Don't be angry. Don't forsake wrath. Amen. Don't get involved in the evil simply because it looks like that's the way, amen, that would be the right way to go. But he said, if you can understand this much, if you wait upon the Lord, hallelujah, there's a blessing that God has for you. Amen. But in verse number 4, it said, delight thyself also in the Lord, and he shall give thee the desires of thy heart. Delight thyself also in the Lord, and he shall give thee the desires of thy heart. Lord Jesus, I know that your word is anointed. I know that you have spoken to my heart. And now I pray, God, that you would help me to present your word, that we would all be a recipients of the blessing of God by setting our heart in a right place, that God, that you would give us the desires of our heart. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you for standing in honor to the Word of God. Amen. There are four basic things. Actually, if you divide it up, I guess you could say that there are five basic things that God, the psalmist told us to do that involve God within our life. Amen. The first thing that he said is to trust in the Lord, amen, and do good. Amen. It's one thing just to trust God, but he is a God that expects us not only to trust him, but he expects us to do good. He went on to say, so shalt thou dwell in the land, and verily thou shalt be fed. In other words, amen, if you want your provision of a roof over your head, amen, and your food, the best way to get your natural provision, amen, of a roof over your head and your food, first of all, is to trust in the Lord, and secondly, to do good. Amen. If I can trust in him, amen, with all of my heart, and if I will do good, then I will be able to dwell in the land, and I will be fed. Verse number 2 said, delight thyself also in the Lord, and he shall give thee the desires of thine heart. Amen. I really believe that whatever we delight in, that's what we involve ourselves in. Yes. Whatever we delight ourselves in, that's what we involve ourselves in. We got a fellow working at the store, and he's probably about 22, 23. Kind of, he doesn't have a college education. Matter of fact, I don't know exactly what grade that he went through. But if you want to know any statistic about any sport that deals with Detroit, hockey, basketball, baseball, football, he can tell you. And he can tell you every name that's on the team. And there's not a day whenever he walks into the break room, you know, just yesterday he walked into the break room and said, how about them Tigers? and with that, he began to tell about every person that hit the ball, about the pitchers that pitched the ball, the opposing team. Matter of fact, we were saying he kind of cute. He's got a little bit of a handicap, and so sometimes he says some things without really thinking about what he's saying. But he's kind of sharp at it at the same time. But we were out on the floor, and he was talking to one of the other guys and he said, "Did you see that guy?" Said he had a T-shirt that wasn't a Tigers T-shirt. That was the team that we were playing against. He said we ought to charge him double. Every time that you talk to him, his delight is in the baseball, in the football, in the basketball, in the hockey. And if Detroit is playing, I can promise you that that guy is going to have it recorded if he has to work. And earlier in the summer, he told me, he says, "I got to see the Tigers play today. I went to the stadium," and I mean, he had the biggest old grin because it was something that he delighted in. Whatever you delight in, you will take time for. I enjoy fishing. I really do. You know what? I have some, a few pieces of trim around my window in my bathroom that need to be put up. Won't take but about 2.5 hours to do it. But you know where I was last night? I didn't catch nothing. But that was my delight. And the trim is going to have to wait because of the thing that I delighted in. But the Bible said, delight thyself in the Lord, and he shall give you the desire of your heart. Now, my mom's mom and dad were polar opposites when it came to spiritual things. My grandfather was an alcoholic, and my grandmother, I want to say this in the right way, she was a Christian. She wasn't a churchgoer, she was a Christian. And grandpa would threaten her, and she went to church anyway. And grandpa took her out of the church, yelled and drug her out of the church. And she went to church anyway. And she'd come home, and in a drunken stupor, he'd have everything out on the porch and trying to kick her out and have passed out. But you know what? She kept going to church. And he wouldn't give her money for the offering. He said, that church don't need no money. But when it came time to take up an offering, there was offering from her because she took in ironing. She had washed clothes and dried them and ironed them a buck a basket. And my birthday present was $2, and that's the way she got my money for my birthday present too. There's only one thing that I really cherish that's a memory to me is an ironing board. That was my grandmother's because she ironed on that thing, and she gave me my birthday money, but she gave to the work of God. And every time that they would say, you know, we're doing a fundraiser, and I was wondering how many here would be willing to make a pie for the fundraiser. And she knew how to make a pie. And she'd raise her hand and she said, you'll have 2 pies from me. You know, the reason she did that was because church was not a place that she just went just to pass the time. But she delighted in the Lord. She'd get out Sunday night and she couldn't wait for Wednesday night. And she'd get out Wednesday night and she couldn't wait for Sunday morning. And she'd get out Sunday morning and she couldn't wait for Sunday night. That was her delight. And this church, my daddy's father and mother were the ones that started this church. And this building that is here, there were men and women that said, I'll dip into my retirement to help build this building. I'll sell peanut brittle. I'll sell burritos. I'll sell, what do they call those things in the corn shells, the tamales? Yeah, you know what they are. Yeah. I'll sell tamales. I'll sell tacos. I'll be here in the morning whenever I could be doing something else, and I'll be working on this church. And this church was built Because there were some men and some women that said, church ain't just a place for a social gathering, but the church is a place that I delight in. I enjoy being in the house of God. It's not just a place that I'm just going to take a little bit of time. Delight thyself in the Lord. Amen. As a matter of fact, on one occasion, my grandfather had the scaffolding set up somewhere toward the middle, I believe it was, of this church. And where was it at? Up on the platform. And he was texturing and taping up there, taping rather, the drywall that was up there. He was on the scaffolding and he fell. He stepped off of the deal and busted up his back and laid up for several weeks. But you know what? He got back up on the scaffolding whenever he got well, taped it up. And the reason that there's a church here today is because church was not something that was just a casual place. But he said, I delight in the Lord. Oh, hallelujah. Amen. And if you delight in the Lord, he will give you the desire of your heart. Now, I remember, amen, on one occasion, we were at a camp meeting. Actually, it happened a bunch of different times, but at one camp meeting, amen, we had gone to. And as we got to camp, amen, the preacher finished preaching, and whenever he finished preaching, everybody just went down to the front. Everybody went down to the front. I'm not talking about it was a time for the sinners to go down to the front. Everybody came down to the front. You know what I'm talking about? Amen. And they came down to the front, and as the musicians would play, they'd rotate musicians so that everybody got a chance to worship. And everybody began to rejoice before the Lord. And a half an hour passed, and an hour passed, and we just kept rejoicing before the Lord. And after about an hour and a half, 2 hours, things began to happen in that place that it was some awesome times that happened. Why? Because there were some folks that said, I've come here for one purpose. Amen. The dining hall and everything that's there, it'll have to wait, because I've come to the house of God because I delight to be in the house of God. I'm delighting myself in the Lord. And when you delight yourself in the Lord, he'll give you the desire of your heart. Oh, hallelujah. Amen. I remember on one occasion as we were in that tabernacle, amen, there was a storm going on the outside of the church, and we were in a tent, and I don't know how many people were there. It didn't really matter, but there were people from different states, and I remember that there were different sisters that had gathered around, and they weren't from the same churches, but they were gathered around in a circle, and they're worshiping God, and they were speaking in tongues, worshiping God, and one of them began to sing, amen, in a heavenly language, a song that none of us knew, amen, singing in tongues, and so none of us knew the language, none of us knew the song, and we watched as a couple more began to sing in the same language, amen, the same song, amen, not anything that they knew, amen, but the Spirit began to give them, amen, but the Spirit began to reveal unto them, amen. What I'm talking about is delighting thyself in the Lord, and
And before it was over, there were about 6 or 8 of them that had joined in together, singing the same song, which none of us in the natural knew, but they sang the same song in the same language. Amen. It impressed me as a child. What happened? Why did that happen that way? Because there were some folks that said, I ain't just coming here, amen, because I have a requirement to be here, but I've come here with one purpose. I'm going to delight myself in the Lord. Hallelujah. And when you delight yourself in the Lord, He will give you the desire of your heart. Oh, hallelujah. Amen. When we were evangelizing, I watched people get drunk on the Holy Ghost. I've never touched alcohol, thank God. It's not a prideful thing, but it's just, I'm thankful that God kept me from that. I've never touched alcohol, but I watched some of these folks get drunk on the Holy Ghost, and I'd say, God, see that? I see folks laughing the Holy Ghost. And I'd say, oh, I have a good time laughing whenever there's a good joke told, but Lord, I'd really like to have the joy of the Lord hit me and I just have to get tickled in the Holy Ghost. And the Holy Ghost was falling down in Rosenberg, Texas. And I said, okay, about the best place for me to be if I want a blessing from God is to get down front where the blessing's being poured out. And so, amen, the altar service was going on, and I just kind of stepped down there, and I began to worship God. I forgot everything else. I know I was supposed to be preaching, amen, the revival, but I'd already finished preaching, so my part was done for the night, and I just kind of turned loose, and I just began to worship God. You know, He gave me the desire of my heart. I got drunk on the Holy Ghost. And I got to laughing so hard, it hurt. But God gave me the desire of my heart. He said, if you will delight thyself in the Lord, He will give you the desires of your heart. Now, what I find is that sometimes the desires of our heart may not be in line with delighting ourselves in the Lord. So how can He give me the desire of my heart if my heart is not lined up with delighting itself in God? And I mentioned this on Wednesday night. Because this has really confused me at times. Whenever I first started, I'd hear people that had this prosperity doctrine that would say, if you'll just name it, you can have that $1 million house. And you can drive that big fancy car. And you can just, and I got confused because mom and daddy started two churches in North Dakota, and I knew they lived for God, but we never had a fancy house. God met our needs, God provided for us, and we had a phenomenal amount of miracles. But we never had, well, we did have one fancy car. God blessed us with a Cadillac one time. It was used. And it was cheaper than what I, but for the most part, we didn't have fancy cars. And there's holes in that doctrine. Because he said He'll give you the desires of your heart, but it's only when you delight thyself in the Lord. I can get a fancy car if I want it, if I'll work hard enough. But you know why I'm going to get it? It's because I've put my heart onto something else. I can get a real nice house if I want it. All I got to do is work 2 or 3 jobs a week.
And I can put my heart into that, and I can say, look, I'm resigning as a pastor, and the only thing that I'm going to do the rest of my life is try to work so that I can get a big fancy house. And I can get that fancy house if I'll just put my heart into that type of thing. Whatever I want with all of my heart, that's what I'm going to get. Amen. But if I can delight myself in the Lord, amen, what the Lord, amen, would want, if I'll rejoice in that type of thing, amen, then He will give me the desire of my heart. That's why whenever we tell somebody, if you want the Holy Ghost, you can have it. I'll tell you what you do. You begin to worship God. Why are you worshiping God? Because if I can get you to delighting in the Lord, if I can get you happy in God, the Holy Ghost is going to come upon you. Amen. He will pour out His Spirit upon you. If you'll delight yourself in the Lord, amen, He will give you the desire of your heart. Oh, hallelujah. You want to be free from the debt load of sin? Delight yourself in the Lord, and He'll give you the desire of your heart. Amen. You want to be healed of sickness? Amen. You delight yourself in the Lord, and it's going to be a blessing that will come because you've delighted yourself in the Lord. Oh, hallelujah. Now, I gotta go down. Now, here's what in Psalms chapter 1 and verse number one, blessed is a man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, amen, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. He said, you're blessed, first of all, amen, by staying away from folks, amen, that would influence you wrong. He's not saying don't have any contact with them. He said, but if they're going to party, don't you go to party. He's not saying don't stay away, just don't ever have contact with them, because how else can we tell them about a better way? But he's saying if you're going to party because they're going to party, you've gone the wrong way. He said you don't walk in the counsel of the ungodly. You don't stand in the way of sinners. You don't sit in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in his law, in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. What was it that we read, that we quoted last week? Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord. Amen. And so this song, the psalmist said, his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. So in other words, amen, if you want to delight in God, one of the things that you're going to be delighting in is in his law. Hallelujah. Amen. You're going to delight in the law of the Lord. And the law of the Lord, amen, the Bible tells me that that's perfect. Hallelujah. Amen. The psalmist also said, I believe it's in 119, where he said, thy word have I hid in mine heart that I might not sin against thee. You know what he's doing? Amen. He's saying, amen, the thing that I take my delight in, amen, is in the way that I should live. What I should do and what I shouldn't do, I'm going to delight myself in that. And if I will delight myself in the law of the Lord, if I let God's law be a part of my heart, then God's going to give me the desire of my heart. Amen. He's going to help me to do right. He's going to help me to live right if I'll delight myself in His law. Amen. That's why he would say, oh, how love I thy law. It is my meditation all of the day. Amen. He said, I love it so much that whenever I meditate on it, it's my meditation all day. He said, I love your words more than I do my necessary food. I don't know about you, but I like to eat. And if somebody told me, now unless I'm fasting, if somebody told me, hey, we got food on the table, do you want to stay in your seat or do you want to come and eat? I know how to eat. And I'll be there. And pretty much anything that's set on the table, I know how to eat. But the psalmist said, here's how I feel about the law of the Lord. It's more than my necessary food. He said, I'm not just talking about a midnight snack. I'm talking about whenever I hadn't eaten all day. Amen. A supper's on the table. And then, I mean, it's a good supper that's just been, you know, fried chicken and mashed potatoes and gravy and broccoli and all the other the things that's going with it. And homemade pie that's sitting there. Oh, man. He said, I need the law of God more than I need that. And whenever I have it, to a point that my heart says, God, whatever you want me to do, whatever you tell me not to do. Where people have problems is they say, this book is nothing but a book of do's and don'ts. You know why it's a book of do's and don'ts? It's because they don't have a love for it. And when your heart is not set to the point where it loves the Word of God, it's hard to live for God whenever you don't love His Word. But if you ever fall in love with it, oh hallelujah, there ain't nothing you wouldn't do for it. Oh hallelujah. We go back to Wednesday night again. One of my classmates from Bible college is a missionary in Egypt. Brother Mokla Sedra. Been there for years. And not this last uprising, but the uprising before, he sat down his two teenage boys and his wife, and he said, I want you to understand the way that the government is getting ready to go. He said, they're getting ready to make Christianity illegal in Egypt. And he said, if they have their way, he said, they will annihilate us because we are Christians. He said, so you have got to make up in your mind that the way of God is not just one of the ways that you can live. But you've got to make up in your mind that God's way is the only way. And Brother Mokla Sedra, amen, right now is in danger of his life because of all of the Muslim Brotherhood that's up in arms right now. But you know what, Brother Sedra has made up in his mind. There's a heart that said, you know what, there's something that's more important to me, amen, than being with the crowd that's right now. I would rather have Jesus than anything. Doesn't matter the house that I live in. It doesn't matter. You know what's happened? It's that heart that becomes right. And when the heart becomes right, amen, you can get the desire of your heart. Sometimes our heart, and I know we deal with this, and God's been working me over for the last couple of weeks, now week and a half. Amen. Examine your heart. Examine your heart. God, where is my heart? What is my passion? What do I really love? What am I really concerned with? I don't know. You know, it's just, again, I go back to that prayer. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. He'll give us the desires of a heart, if we will delight in Him. But in order to get the desire of our heart, our delight has got to be in Him. I've got to be willing to say, my passion is Jesus Christ. My love is the Word of God. Amen. My whole desire is walking with Him and talking with Him and doing what He wants me to do. Amen. I have a walk with Him. Amen. That means more to me than anything else.
Excuse me if I'm embarrassed, but Brother Vest told me, he said yesterday, he said, we went around and I introduced my fiance to everybody in my family. We traveled over 300 miles, and he said, we got back to town, and he said, you know, he said, I thought, I've got to take time with her now, and we went out and walked on the path. You know why? Because Brother Vest has said, the desire of my heart right now is to get married to this young lady, and thank God for that. Amen, because he has fallen, his passion is her, and her passion is his. She left her home to come up here, amen, because there is a desire that they have, amen, to dwell together as a couple. God help us that our passion, amen, would be to the point that we would say, I'm willing to do whatever you want me to do, wherever, whenever, however, whatever. God, I want your will. I want my heart. Amen. The only thing that my heart beats for is more of you, God. I want more of you than I've ever had before. Hallelujah. Amen. You know, you talk about the honeymoon phase. The honeymoon phase, you live for each other and just can't wait to do for each other. And then all of a sudden, you hear somebody say, that was a long time ago. And we don't do quite like we did before because we're past that. We've matured. We don't live there any longer. God said, let me back up. My grandpa told me whenever he'd been married about 55 years, he said, I've been married X number of years, and it was like 50, 55, and he said, and I'm still on my honeymoon. I believe that's possible in the natural, but I also believe that's possible in the spiritual. Amen. The love that we had for him when we first came to God, and we first came to the altar, and we felt the Holy Ghost for the very first time, and we said, oh God, whatever you want from me, I'll do whatever you want. I'll go wherever you... And we made those commitments to God, and we were glad when the church doors opened. Amen. If the preacher said, this is what's wrong, we'd say, you know what, Pastor? I'm going to do my best to stay away from that. Amen. If it's in the Word of God, hey, you know, I see it there. And there were times when God would convict us, and we'd say, you know what? Amen. I was reading in the Bible, and I saw where it's wrong for me to be involved in this. I ought not be saying the things that I'm saying. I ought not be involved in that activity. I ought to be, and we had a love for it. And then all of a sudden, the honeymoon's over, and we say, do we really need to go to all that extreme? What's happened? I'll tell you what's happened. It's the heart. And if I can get my heart back right, if I can turn my heart right, he can give me the desire of my heart. If I turn my heart to the things that I want, the only one that's pursuing it, the thing that I have turned my heart to is me. A good job, a good education, a successful career, whatever it is, I get it. But if I turn my heart to God and I let God be the one that I pursue after in the things of God, then He gives us the desires. He gives us the desires of our heart. So by the help of the Lord, we're trying our best, amen, to get to that point where our heart would be like His heart. Psalms 122 and verse number 1 said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. When it becomes more than just, when church becomes more than the place I have to do on Sunday just to show that I'm a Christian, but it's a place that I'm glad to be in. Psalms 40 and verse number 8, it said, I delight to do thy will, O my God. Yea, thy law is within my heart. I delight to do thy will. Whenever doing the things that God wants us to do is more than just punching a time clock. My
the folks at my job tell me, they say, "Don't you ever get sick of working here?" And I say, "Oh, there's a lot of days whenever I really don't care for it. But every other Friday is a reason that I work at Home Depot. If it wasn't for every other Friday, nah, I don't think I'd be working there. I can promise you I wouldn't be working." And some folks take living for God as, "I'm just doing it because I'm going to heaven. I'm just doing it because I'm punching in. And when the day gets done, I'm punching back out. And I'll punch back in tomorrow. And I'll punch back out because that's all my life is. And that's all they get out of life." But to the person that says, "My heart longs for you. This isn't just a 9-to-5 job, God. Desire you." All of a sudden there's a blessing that begins to pour out upon that individual. Oh, hallelujah. God, I hope I'm expressing this right. I hope that you can feel what the Lord's been dealing with me about, because what He's really wanting from every one of us is a heart that would say, "I'm pushing everything that I can toward the things of God. Everything. Everything. I'll lay aside every weight," as the Hebrew said. "I'm going to lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us. And I'm going to run with patience the race that is set before me. I'm going to look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith." It's with a heart that's full. "And I will delight myself in the Lord, and He'll give me the desires of my heart." The third thing that Psalms 37 says, tells us that we should do in order to receive from God, is commit thy way unto the Lord. Trust also in Him, and He shall bring it to pass. See, some folks want to say, "I trust in God," but there's people that don't want to commit to God. Wait a minute, did you say there's a commitment to this? Yes, there's a commitment to living for God. If you really want the things brought to pass in your life, there has to be a commitment. The reason that Caleb and Joshua got into the land of promise, because somewhere they put a commitment in their heart. And they said, while they're wandering through the wilderness an extra 40 years because of unbelief, there were two men that said, "As for me and my house, we're just going to keep on walking. We may not get there today, but we will get there because we've made a commitment, and we will get into the commit thy way, and He will bring it to pass." The fourth thing, and I'm getting ready to close here. Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for Him. Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for Him. "God, I didn't get the desire of my heart today. I felt like there would be at least a couple, three visitors that we had invited yesterday that would be in church this morning. I really did. But they're not here today so far. But you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to rest in the Lord. I'm going to say, God, this church is in Your hands. And I'm waiting patiently on You." See, because He's put a new heart. He's begun a heart transplant in me. And I'm going to do everything that I can to wait patiently on Him. Because I know that if I can wait, I don't see it today, but I really believe that on this side there's going to be a bunch of people that's going to be sitting, and the Holy Ghost is going to begin to fall, and folks are going to come to the altar. I believe that there's going to be people on this side that's going to start coming in, and we're going to say, "Where in the world did those folks come from? Did you invite them?" "No, I didn't invite them." "Amen. They just came." And I'm going to watch as folks come in, And and the next thing I know, the waters of baptism are going to be troubled, and folks are going to be baptized in the precious name of Jesus Christ. And just out of nowhere, amen, there's going to be folks just raising their hands in the middle of the song service and being filled with the Holy Ghost. You know what that is? Amen. It's whenever we put our heart into the things that are right, and that's my passion, and that's what I love, and that more than anything else in my life, amen, I want somebody to receive the Holy Ghost. More than anything else, I want to baptize somebody in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. Because, hey, it's an awesome experience to have your sins being washed away. And I want that experience, and I want to see folks repenting of their sins. Amen. I desire that. And if I wait patiently, God will give me the desire of my heart. Well, hallelujah. If I put everything that I have into the things of God, God, hallelujah, amen, will pour out a blessing for me. Oh, praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for Him. He said, if you'll understand that if you'll wait on Him, God will help you and God will bless you. They shall inherit the earth. Those that wait upon the Lord, they shall inherit the earth. So, the challenge comes today from Joel chapter 2 and verse number 12. Therefore also now saith the Lord, turn ye even to me with your whole heart, with fasting and with weeping and with mourning, and rend your heart and not your garments. Turn unto the Lord your God, for He is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and of great kindness, and repenteth him of the evil. Who knoweth if he will return and repent and leave a blessing behind him, even a meat offering and a drink offering unto the Lord your God. He said, you've allowed your heart to be distanced from me. What I'm calling you to do is to return your passion to the thing that where it needs to be. Turn even unto me with your whole heart. He said, take that old heart that's in your flesh and rend it. Break that old stony heart. How many times have we had to go to an altar and say, oh God, forgive me. Forgive me. Forgive me. The tears begin to flow. You know what's happening? There's a broken heart. For Psalms gave us this indication. He said, the Lord is nigh unto them that are of a broken heart. Saveth such as be of a contrite spirit. He said, the sacrifices of God are a broken spirit and a broken and a contrite heart. Thou wilt not despise. Whenever Peter began to preach the message on the day of Pentecost, and I've got two more Bible verses, and we're going to shut up, amen, for this morning. But in Acts chapter 2, he began to preach his message, and verse number 37 had said, when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart, their old callous heart. Amen. It heard the word of God. When they were convicted, they said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? And Peter said, if you'll repent, break that heart up. He said, if you'll get rid of the filth of your past, if you'll repent, and if you'll be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of your sins, ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. If you'll break up your heart, God will do the rest, and He will fill you with a new spirit.
Yes.
Oh, hallelujah. Ezekiel gave us this heart transplant definition, for he said in Ezekiel 36 and verse number 24, this is the final verse that I'm going to read, "For I will take you from among the heathen. I will gather you out of all countries, and I will bring you into your own land." He's talking there about a spirit of repentance. I'm going to take you out of a heathen mindset, out of a heathen heart, and I will bring you into your own land. You don't belong in the world. You belong into the kingdom of God. You don't belong doing the things, amen, of darkness. You belong doing the things of light. He said, first of all, I've got to bring you. That's repentance. Then I will sprinkle clean water upon you. Amen. And you shall be clean from all your filthiness. Even from your idols will I cleanse you. Amen. That's a type of water baptism by immersion in the name of Jesus Christ. And when you're baptized for the first time in your life, you're clean. Oh, hallelujah. Amen. Amen. The old things passed away. Behold, all things become new. And then he said in verse number 26, "A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. And I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you an heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you, and I will cause you to walk in my statutes, and you shall keep my judgments and do them. And you will dwell in the land that I gave to your fathers, and you shall be my people, and I will be your God." He said, if you will, in verse number 24, if you'll leave the life that you've lived before, if you'll, in verse number 25, I'll clean you up. In verse number 26, I'll take away a stony heart and I will give you a heart of flesh. In verse number 27, and I will put my spirit in you and I will cause you to live. And I will bless you, amen. And you will dwell in the land that I gave to your fathers. And you shall be my people. And I will be your God. Oh, hallelujah. Let's stand together. Hallelujah. He will give us the desire of our heart if we will delight in Him. Lord Jesus, I love you. Let's worship Him. Come on, everybody. Let's worship the Lord. I love you, Jesus. Help me, God, that every day that I live, that I would delight in you. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. I praise you, God. Thank you for all that you have done and are doing today. Praise the name of the Lord. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus.
Just to walk with Him.